knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
As discussed, archaeological excavation is an inherently destructive process. This is why many excavations must meet strict criteria before they can proceed. In the U.S., an excavation must usually be overseen by an RPA, or Registered Professional Archaeologist. Similar laws exist around the world. This archaeologist holds a master's degree in anthropology or archaeology and has a few years of experience in overseeing archaeological investigations. This is to ensure that archaeological sites aren't destroyed unless strict data collection methods are followed. Until recent advancements in archaeological theory, the field was often unethical in practice. Sites were excavated without much care to reach some desired find. Trying to tease out context and good data from early excavations is a source of endless frustration for modern archaeologists. While the loss of archaeological data is certainly an annoyance in the field, unethical archaeological practice affects much more than just the science of archaeology. For a long time, sites, artifacts, and features were seen as simple data points to archaeology. However, it is critical to keep in mind that these are also objects of cultural heritage to living people. The destruction of cultural sites and the taking of cultural artifacts is unethical archaeology, simply put. A more egregious practice, however, was the taking of human remains from communities who didn't want archaeologists there. Archaeology is a Western discipline. It was born during the age of colonization during the Scientific Revolution. Western scientists commonly excavated, studied, and kept the remains of indigenous people's ancestors. This was without any consultation with those indigenous people, and often expressly against their will. This happened until very recently all over the globe. However, as indigenous rights groups gained more influence and archaeology broadened into a field not solely occupied by Western scientists, this began to change. In the USA, a law was put into place in 1990 called NAGPRA, or the Native American Graves Protection and Repatriation Act. Many other similar acts were put into place around the world. This gave indigenous people ownership of their ancestors' remains and burial goods. It also outlined processes of returning human remains and burial artifacts already in collections, which is called repatriation. Even in 1990, this was opposed by many archaeologists who believed scientific inquiry was more important than repatriation. Today, though, the vast majority of archaeologists agree this was an important part of making archaeology an ethical science. Even so, thousands of indigenous people's remains are still in museum and university collections. This is another reason that professional archaeologists are required to oversee excavations. They understand the laws and steps to take for uncovering burials. This doesn't mean that the analysis of burials isn't done in archaeology. They are still important features that tell us a lot about the past. However, they are done with permission and support of local and ancestral communities, who are often also curious about their past. An important part of modern archaeological theory is that archaeologists don't have a right to people's cultural heritage. They should work with the people whose ancestors they study for ethical archaeology. This is a slow process, as decades of unethical practice have made many people distrustful of archaeology. If an archaeologist's data collection method is unethical, the findings often won't make it through peer review. Hopefully, this has highlighted the importance of protecting archaeological sites and dissuading amateur excavation. As we are now familiar with the development of archaeological theory, dating methods, artifacts and features, surveys, excavations, and ethical practices in archaeology, we are now ready to learn what archaeology has uncovered about our past.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.